On Monday, Christian Cooper, a 57-year-old Black Harvard graduate and Audubon Society member, was birdwatching in Central Park. And nearby, a white woman, Amy Cooper, openly broke a rule for that area of the park to let her dog run wild off the leash. The Black man asked her to put her dog on a leash, re the fucking rules of the park, and this white woman was so mad that a Black person told her to follow a rule that she called the police. She lied about being threatened. She mentioned several times that he was African American.
I'm going to tell them there's an African American man threatening my life. And there is a man, African American. There is an African American man. I am in Central Park.
Yeah, I think she just said that, you know, just in case the police didn't think she was really threatened. In America, being Black means you're inherently a threat. And when you're white, you're inherently innocent. She was hoping she could convince the police to, at best, come and arrest this man in the park and pity her, a poor, defenseless white woman, and her white dog. The man took a video of the encounter on his phone. The video came out. She was swiftly identified, and yesterday she lost her job as a vice president at an investment firm. Her dog was repossessed by the shelter she adopted it from, and the Audubon Society dragged her in a tweet in part saying, quote, "The outdoors and the joy of birds should be safe and welcoming for all people. A sentiment I agree with, but wow, did it really need to be said?" Now, you may be thinking, her whole life is ruined because she tried to use the police as her personal hitman, or she made a mistake. But there was no mistake. She was fully consenting and alert when she did this. She chose racism. Contrarily, you may be thinking, yay, this is justice, but it's not justice. Justice is about doing what is fair. She got consequences for her actions, but justice would be a lot harsher than losing the privilege of a job and a dog. So think hard about what would be justice.
Right, and that brings us to the second story.
Yeah, this story is the ghost of Christmas future, except it's real. If the police that showed up to the call about the birdwatching man hadn't resolved things peacefully, if he hadn't been lucky, he may have suffered the same fate as George Floyd in Minneapolis, who was accused of forgery. Floyd was a Black man who was arrested and handcuffed on the ground. He wasn't resisting. He was handcuffed. And a white police officer knelt on his neck. He screamed that he couldn't breathe for several minutes until he stopped. Onlookers begged for the other three cops at the scene to intervene. They just stared back. Floyd was pronounced dead at the hospital. The four officers were fired, and the FBI has opened a civil rights investigation. The officers have not yet been charged with murder, but again, they lost the privilege of a job. The video of George Floyd's murder was haphazardly retweeted into the feeds of Black people everywhere to say, look at this horrible thing a police officer did to a Black person. But the voyeuristic nature of sharing Black human beings murdered, just a normal thing on a Tuesday, didn't bring that guy back. It didn't stop racism. In fact, racism didn't end when we all saw Mike Brown laying in the street, or when the Ahmaud Arbery video went viral, or when Eric Garner was choked to death over a few cigarettes, or Walter Scott getting shot to death. Did racism end when Danny Ray Thomas was shot on video by police? Did Stephon Clark's viral murder change the way white people react to Black people just living their lives? When Keith Scott was shot to death, did white people even have a conversation about a culture that produces this kind of incessant bias and violence? Did Philando Castile's murder video, did that end racism? Did the photo of Emmett Till in a casket stop racism? Did it stop murder? How about Alton Sterling? Did it force all police departments to rebuild from scratch, weeding out the bad apples that have spoiled the whole goddamn bunch? Did it make white people evaluate themselves for even half a second? Are there people on Earth who are unaware that Black people fear the police because the police disproportionately kill Black people? Do we need videos to prove it? And do the videos ever result in justice? I mean, we've had smartphones that shoot video since, 2005? We know this happens. Awareness isn't the point. We don't share white death like this, okay? When Steve Irwin died, we didn't share the video of the stingray millions of times online to raise awareness. They take down videos of ISIS beheading white men on YouTube. How many white men have you watched die in HD video? Can you name 5? Because I bet you can't name 10. The video footage is shorthand for desensitization. Ask yourself why you're even comfortable looking at a video of someone being murdered. Then ask why you'd share it with everyone you know. If it was a dog, you wouldn't. So what's the reasoning? For what reason should we share footage of a person being murdered? Okay, I'm traumatized. Black people are traumatized. 4 police officers got fired. They didn't get murdered. They will hopefully be charged with murder, but they probably won't. But that isn't justice, and it doesn't address a system that puts a gun and a badge in the hands of a person who could hear someone pleading for their life and not move. So when I say don't look away, I don't mean consume Black death like it's a meme on TikTok. I mean look in the mirror. Look at your family. Look at the community you live in. Look at your friend group. Look at the wealthy white woman with the rescue dog in the goddamn park, okay? And don't look away. Because we know what the problem is. No one is unclear on what the problem is. So where is the justice?